Listen, pal, we gotta work something out here. I got a show tonight. I got a show at the Mirage. At the Mirage. They got people waiting in the dressing room to take my place. You can't make me lose my contract. Come on, man, please. Let's work out a deal.
Are you the one they call the greatest poet in the world?
Yeah, that's the whole point. That's why I'm gotta play. That's why I gotta play the Mirage.
Tell me a poem.
It doesn't work that way. If you want a poem, then you gotta talk to my agent, number one. And we're not gonna talk to my agent. I gotta get back to America. Listen, I got the number on my phone. Let's just call the president. Let's call the Secretary of State. We'll figure this out. Let's get me back home. Let's do this.
Oh, you mean like the U.S. Secretary of State, John Kerry?
I was having a fight with my ketchup wife and ran away to North Korea.
You are useless, dude.
This is my second biggest fuck-up.
Oh, John.
So, hey, while you guys are having a moment over there, why don't you tell me a poem?
Like I said, I'm not gonna do that, okay? John, we're gonna be fine. Like we'll get out of this. I'm not telling dictators poems, okay?
Well, okay, then let me try one more thing. If you don't tell me a poem,
yeah,
we're gonna kill Secretary of State John Kerry.
Thanks, bud. We got this. All right. You want a poem? I got a poem for you. Here we go.
Well, dustily the dawning sun arose to light a bleak Dakota winter's day. I swung my mattock on a fracking rig and slavish sweated, saving up my pay. My cell phone buzzed. I dropped the pick to pick it up. Oh, my wife, with labor in her voice, began to shout, "The baby's on the way!" I found my boss and said, "Hey, I'm gonna go."
Like fucking hell you are, I need you here.
Crowd of roughnecks gathered round to watch him swell and pop.
There's drilling to be done. There's treasure to be blasted out of that dirt.
You keep your dirt, I said. And keep your natural gas. My wife just called. My baby's coming fast. I'm gonna see that child born. Oh, he blustered. But them roughnecks cheered. I bounced inside my GMC. A diesel. 93. And started her in third. In Bismarck, across the mountains lay my wife. A windy 190 miles away. When 520 miles had felt my tread and 15 minutes, maybe less, my dash began to beep and whistle, quick and shrill, to warn me I was nearly out of gas. I glimpsed a hovel, half abandoned, with a pump. I braked and barreled in and told the gas boy, "Fill her up!" Then found I left my wallet down beneath my bunkroom bed. I told the kid, he spat and drawled, "Hey, John, oh, no cash, no gas, now hit the road!"
Now listen, please, I got a baby being born in fucking Bismarck, man. I need that gas!
You know the mountain road's been closed because of snow. You can't get through. A blizzard's blocked the pass.
Drop that road, you're gonna die.
Well, shit. Guess you'll need a little gas to try. A hand across a barren plain, a range of sheer and sudden snow-cased mountains loomed. Their upper slopes enshrouded by a mist both gray and grim and menacing to see. Across my path with flashing lights, a lower gate on sentry stood and bore this sign that warned, "Turn back! It's suicide to try!" I stopped to chain my tires up, then drove on by, up gorges carved by windborne daggers, cold and sharp. Above a jagged precipice that dropped into a frozen stream a mile below, I steered two-handed, knuckles white, my tires slipping. Losing traction on the ice, I shifted low and locked the hubs until, now blinded by a swirl and fog, I cranked her down to four and crawled up slope. Three times I dropped a tire off the edge and twice retreated down a grade too steep to curse and grab a run and start and throw a rear end swerving through the drift. I topped the peak and skidded slowly down the backside to the mountain's far off base. I rolled the brakes, I smelled them burn. I watched with dread each minute, fearing I'd be late. I twisted down that turning way until I hit the winter brown Dakota plains beyond the storm's domain. Then dropped my chains and laugh and punched my pedal through the flow. Just when before me uprose Bismarck Town, slender spired city beckoning to me like Eden never lost. Behind me in my mirror pulsed a trooper's lights for speeding recklessly and licenseless. He tried arresting me, and though I told him I was gonna see my child born, he wouldn't quit. I dored him, then escaped, careening closer to my soon-born child. I counted, closing on a dozen cops behind me, sirens blaring, but I dodged their roadblocks, then I hit the city streets. I blasted through the traffic lights and squealed around the corners. Two-wheeled, leaning on the horn and on the sidewalk, passing cars with swarms of sirens swirling close behind. I ditched the truck still running, cycling through the spinning doors and found a tended desk where, calmly as I could, I said my name and asked my wife, "What number room is she?" Policeman, like a pack of savage apes pursuing, hollering onto the scene. I split, they followed, knocking over beds and sleeping patients up to fluid bags. I slammed my shoulder through a door. She smiled. She gasped. She screamed! And sighed. And as they cuffed me on the floor, I heard sung from a pair of once used lungs, a warm, tiny wail.
Not good enough!
What'd you mean?
Why did you lie to me?
I didn't lie to you.
You said you were the world's greatest poet.
I am the world's greatest poet.
No, I'm a filthy American liar. Henchman!
Oh! No,
hey,
no,
just a minute. You know,
this is the Secretary of State! What are you? Oh, sweet Jesus, do you know what is going to happen to you as the Secretary of State?
Hey, why don't you tell me another poem?
I'm not going to tell you another poem. You just killed the Secretary of State.
Oh, okay. Hey, henchman. Grab that lady right there.
What?
Hey, no, you don't need to be, you don't need to be killing the ladies. What are you doing?
Hey, I'm just trying to make sure the best poetry coming out of the world's greatest poet. So let's play a game here. It's called You Tell Me a Poem. If it's not shitty, we won't kill that girl.
Fucking egg. All right. Okay. Yeah, we got this. Jess said goodbye to all her friends one teary night, and goodbye to her family that morn, then left her home to try and live a dream.
9 days I jounced inside of a rusty truck, in a caravan, along untamed roads. The hills and streams I knew my world to be just fell from the land to pure rocks and dust and sun. There were strange jagged sandstone spires and vulture's wings loomed ahead. As I disembarked alone, the caravan rolled forward. Around and thought, how could a place so barren be called a home? The people glowered as harshly as the sun, their language scoured like a sandstorm's rasp. The town had one dirt road, and this was overrun by tumbleweeds and flea-bit alley dogs. The university I found to be a dull and provincial pit. My duties were rote, repetitive, numbing. And the men who ran it, they were just dust-beamed and calcified. Was this what I really wanted? This? Really? I left my home to be a scientist. I wanted to study the living things. Eggs, chicks, strange lizards that plumed. The living things. But here, there was no such life, as I saw through the days and the weeks and the dreary months, with none so much as to say hello to in the hall while I shuffled from and to my microscope. I ate my lunch outside every day. And here, finally, I made a friend, a one-eyed dog, with scars, with mange, with patchy fur and fangs. I'd slip him scraps and scratched him as he stretched. The seasons changed, a little different each time. My skin took in the grit of the desert. My tongue, the still of time everlasting, unchanged. But my smile, cracked and wilted, drying out. The letters from home came few. And when I tried to picture those hills, I knew I saw just rock. And then when I tried to remember the laughs of friends, I only heard the jeers of leering men. But hell, I got myself here, and just as easily I could get myself out. I exhausted myself night after night, drafting petitions to other posts. I sent them anywhere and everywhere. No one and nowhere could be as hard as these people in this place here. And one by one they came back. We're sorry, but... etc. Perhaps next year. And then 2 months passed since I last heard from home. And the night when my last rejection came, I thought, hell, I'm sick of pacing in my cell alone. Tonight, I will find some company. I don't much like to drink, but well, I'd rather do that than think. So I walked into the one bar, a spit-floored place, where I laid some nickel down for a glass of swill. Then two. Then four. Oh. And suddenly I found my company. Three men trading insults for attention while clumsily excusing aggressive gropes. My vision was spinning, and six drinks deep, I made my way away from them, out of the bar. I stumbled and saw a shadow slipping from the doorway, blocking the light. I turned, walked away, stumbled twice, heard a step, and then spun around. He said,
"Don't worry, honey, this won't hurt a bit. These streets ain't safe. Why don't you let me take you home?"
I turned and I ran. He followed, calling. I fell into a hole. He came up and said,
"Don't worry, baby. You won't hurt a bit."
I heard a growl in the dark. A single green eye gleaming bright. I heard a roar and it split through the vicious night. A black shape snarled and slammed into the man. Fangs snapping, he grabbed for the throat and grabbed into some flesh and arm and tore. He roared and swore a holy roar and then ran away. And my friend, tongue lolling in a wisdom grin, came padding up to lick my face. And I smiled, I hugged, I laughed, and I cried. I rose forward and stumbled home with my friend by my side.
See, there's no reason to go about killing people. That's pretty good, right? Like, that's, look at this. This is a woman. This is a real life person. You don't need to be, you don't need to be mad about anything. You don't need to be committing murders or anything.
Heaven!
Hey, you know, you can leave her the fuck alone, all right? Don't you start anything.
I haven't used my drink ticket yet.
Hey! Oh my god! Hey! Hey! What are you? What is the matter with you?
You know, when I discovered the unicorn land underneath the temple in Pyongyang City, I truly knew what it was to be mesmerized. You, sir, have not done that for me.
You ever discovered a unicorn lair? That doesn't exist. This is the closest that you're ever gonna get. There's no unicorns here. There's no art here.
So a man that doesn't believe in unicorns says he's the greatest poet in the world.
You gotta know that, huh?
Thus far, you've given me two pieces of garbage.
All right, I've had enough. You want a poem, Kim Jong-un? Yeah, you want a poem?
That's what I've been asking for.
Okay, well, then you're gonna get one, all right? I had a bottle warming by my heart, and still another 40 miles till I hit Nevada. Drowsy in the waste, I toped and plodded with my thumb up down the road. A pair of headlights showed and slowed until before me I beheld some Euro joke. This flash red, blue slung, three-wheeled piece of shit I didn't recognize. I got inside. Some. This thing's got a motorcycle block, I asked him as we wind away. He jumped and told me with a jitter, "Don't worry, kid, she's got a little rev." He said no more. until behind us in the distance came the cop cars, and above us rotors thumped. You pulling over, man? I asked. He glared and cranked his lever down. This is the switchblade, cried the man, and slowed to let the wings and tail unfold. He floored the gas. Our wheels jumped off the road, he cried. The world's first and only flying car. He grabbed the wind and rode it close. Below us in confusion, cop cars dwindled, and their helicopter fell behind. We skimmed above the waste into Nevada's nights. Where to? Fuck, man, I got no idea. The moon? Does go that high? The plan was Reno, but I'll tell you, man, that I'm on board to ride all night. You stole this car then, right? The car was mine to steal. It's been my car throughout. It's always been my car. They can't take this too away from me. I let that sit and watched the moonlight sear the desert till he told me that he had no place to go. I can't go back. I don't see any happiness ahead. The car was mine, okay? The car was my idea. I dreamed it up, I drew the plans, I did the math, got the money, figured out the laws, and built it. Now it's all that's left. He's got it now, got her, got everything. And I'm a ruin. But I've got the car, goddammit, and I'll fly straight to the sea before I let the bastard win. Now she's kissing him. And it's his arms her fingers will be running down, and his ears she'll be breathing jasmine into, just like she's been. My God, these years she's been. He turned to look my way and said, don't trust. Don't give them anything they can take. I pulled my bottle out. Shared a swig. I lit a spliff and said, so, tell me, man. I didn't see it coming. I only saw the switchblade. It consumed my mind. Thought about it in our bed and in the shower. Never thought of when. She started drinking more, I think. She made a fight. She wore more makeup. God knows why. She crashed three cars, took this trip to France, bought a $7,000 dress. Then silence. She wouldn't speak to me, and I saw nothing I'd need to say. So night and day, I left Gwen home alone. So in my hangar, I could drool and play. I knew him through his work, and he knew me through mine. That slime, all of them, him? What did she see in him that she didn't see in me? And me, I see a traitor and a thief. So what else could I do? Just let it go? Just say hello when passing in the store and watch them fly away? Just creep through life beneath the shadows hanging overhead? Besides, they have no right to it. It's mine. It's mine! I only took the last thing that was mine, and so I have it now. What's the point? What's living without love?
Ahead us stretched Nevada's nighted waste. In silence, still and solemn, bare of cloud, vast and empty, and we flew above it, up apart, without a purpose known.
Henchman!
Whoa, hey.
Right. Pump! This is a beautiful flag.
Flag.
The beautiful colors of the Democratic People's Republic of North Korea. Red, white, and blue. The red, you know what it symbolizes?
I would say 7 of the 13 states.
No, not the South Koreans. The white, do you know what this represents?
8 of the 13 states?
The purity of North Korea. And do you know what the blue stands for?
No, what is it?
The twin water dragons I can summon at any moment. True prestige.
Hey! You didn't just do that!
Oh, yes I did.
Wait, that doesn't make any sense. He's your own man. Why are you killing him? That's nothing to do with Papone.
I may have a little bit of a reputation, but the truth be told is I'm a very sympathetic man. I put him out of his misery from having to listen to your shitty poetry.
That's it. I slammed the door and left!
The door stayed shut. The silence of our Snowden yard swelled up. I'm sorry, Jess, I said, and reached back for the knob. And stopped. And turned. And walked away. I ain't marrying a mycologist, she'll want to study mushrooms. Now was her big chance. The university had scored their grant. She'd been selected. Oh, and she'd die to go. Well, great. And good for her. But how could she not see the cost? A lifetime's chance for sure. But would she trade our world, our whole life, for fungus? Fuck! So what? It blows on Mars! My footprints mashed on melting snow. No breeze blew through the fingers of the trees. The road sloped off downhill and towards the lights of town. Head down, I fumed. No moon tonight, just stars. So there grew life on Mars. Of course you'd want to study, ponder, wonder how it came to be. Of course, he'd love to see how strange these grows, to learn what none alive could teach. Strange life on Mars. Well, so there's always been strange life on Earth that grows, and only fools would think there's nothing left on Earth to know. There's plenty of fungi here. I go so far. The downtown bustled all around me as I, hands in pockets, jostled through the crowd that threaded, smiling and shouting down the boulevard while herds of cars whirred by. There'd be no crowds on Mars. No cars. No lights. No restaurants. No bars. Well, probably a bar. No life besides this lichen. So why trade this noise, this joy, for silent rust? Jess. For good a restaurant alone. For good an empty home. What good the sun that doesn't shine on Jess? What good these hands without her to caress? What good in life? I passed young couples kissing in the street. Grandfathers buying grandsons sweets, past gangs of young men looking for some girls to meet. From open doors, the chords of love songs rang. I need to let her go. Right? I can't stand in her way. I'll be okay. The world is full of love. We'll find love again. And Jess will find some other man. Blood froze. No! Some other man for Jess to spend her life with? No! And all we've shared, my life and hers combined, to lose that? Jess was Jess. No other girl could be. I stopped. And the crowd kept moving. Where to now? Three bars were near. I didn't want to drink. Coffee shop where I could sit and think. Did I go home? Not yet. I walked again. Out here, away from town, the streets slept still. The snow lay undisturbed. My parents' house, just down Arbutus to the right. They'd be asleep. And this wasn't their choice to make. Besides, what if they thought that I should stay? They couldn't bear for me to be so far away. How could I tell them no? And leave? And watch them age and die on Skype? Well, Mom would say, of course they miss me, but they'd never stand between me and my wife. Go with your heart, Bill, Mom would say. Dad would grunt out, fuck, we're dirt soon anyway. I left the sleeping lane and headed for the path along the river so it'd pace beneath the trees along my favorite walk. The distant stars shone down. Which one was Mars? How many billions, trillions, spread through time had left their homes behind? My grandfather's from Ireland. My great-grandmother was from France. It could be done. I wouldn't die.
but maybe they possess some trait I lacked. Some strength I just don't share. I'd miss my home too much. But if I lost my mind, then I'd be hurting Jess much worse than if I stayed. A snowbound meadow curved before me to a river rimed with ice. A thin fog swayed. Oh, Jess loved this walk. The first time we had kissed had been here. Underneath that willow there. It wouldn't be a river walk on Mars. Nowhere I've been happier than here. How many happy days with Jess spent here? How many summer memories here shared? How many happy memories with Jess? Was this river, beautiful as it may be, as beautiful as Jess? These trees, and was this planet life itself? My soul? I cut across the meadow to the feet, stamped my feet to clear the snow, and walked until I hailed a cabbie driving by.
I sat in my pajamas near a glass of wine. And jumped, he came inside. I'm gonna turn it down, I said. I don't wanna go in.
God damn it, Jess. I'm such an ass. You're just too good for me. Let's go to Mars. Let's go. We'll raise a family there. Why not? My home is you.
Release the hell! Can I talk to you for a moment? Artist to artist.
Okay.
On my father's last day as Earth before he became an angel and ascended to heaven, he once told me, true art is supposed to make you feel something. It's supposed to make you a better person when it's all said and done. And here you are taking a shit in front of me.
You gotta watch the way you talk about art, alright? What are you, artist? You don't know anything about it. You're the most evil man in the world.
I'm not evil. I created a pill that cures swine flu, AIDS, and cancer.
Well, that's art at least, but that's not... You came up with that, but that's not evil. You didn't do that for real.
You're an expert on art? Okay, tell me a poem.
I am.
It's not garbage. How's that?
I have told you four poems that are not garbage. You want another one? You want another one? I'll go right here.
And make sure it means something.
Artist. All right. Let me just get set for a second. I'll give you a fucking poem, Kim Jong-un. We opened up the door and for the first time smelled the river air in our new home. The city and its burdens seemed to fade as on its mossy banks our two boys played. But though we smiled and introduced ourselves to all we met, our courtesy begat just frowns and downturned eyes, hostile glares and mutterings that hinted us, beware.
The old and ugly man that ran the store that sold both bait and ammo told me,
get away from here, miss. Take your children, go back where you come from. Run, I tell you, run.
But when my wife reported this, I scoffed. These rubes, I said. They don't like change, so what? They don't like city folk, who cares? We're here, and here is home, and home is where we stay.
So we stayed. Our children learned to boat and fish by idling hours on the summer's gentle dusks. Their conversation ran with perch and trout. One day, our elder boy and my darling, sweet and joyful Jonathan stayed long and late out fishing, missing dinner, curfew, and his bedtime as our worries slowly swelled. Well,
by midnight, still he wasn't back, and fear turned noxious in our guts until I grabbed the lights, then burst into the night to call his name. But from the dark, no echo came. I trampled reeds and rushes, scaring frogs into the water, flushing nightbirds and the marshland serpents, calling out his name until I could no more. But from the dark, no echo came.
that morning, shivering, bedraggled, more a ghoul than man, I met the officers outside my door, and with them, wading through the river's rancid mist in hopeless search, they hunted silence, fearfully, as if intruding where they had no right to be, until we found the boat, but not my boy. They said,
"Your son is drowned. Let's go home."
I cried for hours, days, then weeks, and on. And on each wind I hear his voice, only to lift my head and learn the iron truth. My boy was dead. Sweet Jonathan was dead. I made my Andrew promise never to be by the river close to dark, and shook with the frets if ever for an instant he were out of sight. I couldn't sleep at night. For torturous hours I lay awake beside my husband, hearing phantom slurps and sucking, rustling slithers circling around outside, afraid my mind was no more mine. For I dreaded sunset and the dying of the day, the terror and the madness that would ever louder screech and clatter in my brain. Until the night the horror came. Our Labrador began to whimper and growl. It whimpered again. Silence fell. My hairs all rose. A creaking came, and then a scrape. I choked on air, decayed like wet, worm-eaten meat.
My wife shook me awake and whispered,
"Joe, there's something in the house."
"No way," I said. "Suzanne, it's in your head. Look, I know it's hard. I feel it too. But what we need is just to get over this. We need to think about something else for a little."
I heard my Andrew scream. For just a million year-long minute, we could not control our frames. Then, like a siege stone through a barricade, there came a crash. His door was splintered, swinging from a single hinge. A carcass smell hung rank and toxic in the dark. I flipped the lights. Found his bedroom bloodied, smeared with gore. I hemorrhaged out a gurgle, sob, soon began to wail. And down the stairs I glimpsed something that could have been a fleeing tail, and chased it, bellowing in blood I paid.
My husband burst through the hole where once hung our door. He raved and screamed out savage, manic barks. I tried to follow to hold him back, but he was gone. I called the cops and begged for them to help. "You have to come," I pleaded. "Something in the night. My husband's gone. It took my baby, please.
Listen,
there's
ma'am.
Blood and trail and mud and weeds. Please help."
"Listen, ma'am. We can't come now. Stay inside and lock the doors. We'll come at dawn. It's just too late. Your son is gone. I'd run tomorrow while you can."
Some hours later, clothes in tatters, smeared in river muck and blood that oozed from cuts and scrapes uncounted, Joe returned home and held me in the ruins of our home.
A policeman came. Policemen went. They seemed to feel no sorrow for our loss, refused my questions angrily, and said,
"Best guess we got? Coyotes. Lock your doors at night."
"That pack of rats," I said, "they know. But they're too scared to talk about it, even much less do their jobs. They'd rather play pretend and hide. God damn them to the dark as hell!"
"I just don't care, Joe," I replied. "I want to go. We need to leave, or else every night I'll hear his scream, and every time I watch the water dream of Jonathan below." A shudder shook my husband, and he stared past me, past the willows gnarled by the river, past the world we shared, into someplace unknown to me alone.
"I heard it feast out in the night. I tracked it by the cracks of bone, and as I neared the squelch of daring flesh, till before me, bathed in pallid moonlight,
I placed my hand against his cheek and felt a fever burning deep beneath his skin.
I felt a pressure build behind my brain, a vision narrowed, tinting slowly red.
I don't know if this monster has a name, I said, but Sue, I'm gonna take its head.
I left her sitting there and climbed the stairs, still greased with muck that to the attic led. And from its shabby padlock case, I took the rifle that my father passed to me. I scoured off the rust and loaded rounds, then waited for the dusk.
Joe, please. I said don't go. You won't come back. Don't leave me, Joe. Let's find another home. Let's start again.
I can't. I'll never sleep again. Wherever we would go, I'd know that when the time had come for me to stand and fight, I'd run. My duty to our boys, I'm done.
The final rays of day were setting. As he puttered up the river, I heard the engine's drone run short of breath, then wheeze into the night's enormity. For hours, I stretched my ears in foolish hope by the bank to hear the engine's drone, the crack of the rifle, my husband's weary steps returning home. Unendingly, I heard the river flood. That river's sickly, gleeful bubbling that hung around my neck as if all the weight of the world collapsed into a moat. The day birthed gray and weak and still and cold. I watched two plagues slap mournful against the bank. We plodded up the steps into the withered husk that once housed our home to find a cardboard box and pack my things. But before I'd emptied out a dresser, though, I wondered where'd I go. Down on every road, forever, I could go and never find my home, my loves, my life, my boys, my Joe. How could such empty life as that be worth the slow, scabbing torment life would be when every thought of love or family would cause my never-healing wound to bleed? Inside the bait and ammo store, I said, I understand now why you warned me, run!
Good, you're leaving then.
No, I've come to buy your biggest gun!
Go. I don't need your blood on my hands. Get out, go home.
I said, what's mine? They're red already, stained with Andrews and Johns and Joes. I have no home. Prepared to face the river's dread alone and join my dead, I saw etched steel reveal itself beneath his face.
I've seen your stare before above the 38th. I've worn that mask you're wearing now. I know it hides a heedless hate, and I hope you live to see it fade. Mine did. My war's long done. Here starts another one, and I won't run.
He turned, pulled a key outside of his vest, opened up a door, and said,
for me, an M16 and four grenades. For you, I think my good AK.
But as we piled ordnance on his boat, a cop drove by and asked us our intent.
To fish! Come join us!
The old man laughed and said,
come join us!
It isn't worth it, Philly, you fool. You won't come back. Just leave the river be.
Too long we've huddled fearful in the night. It's time to live. It's time to fight.
The cop's eyes fell. We drove away and launched into the river with our rifles close at hand. I scanned the water, searching for the horror that its murky currents hid. Forever stretched the night. The bullfrogs belched. Small ripples lapsed against our hull. Vapor spread across the sky and shrouded us in gloom. My eyelids dipped and drooped and dropped and jerked wide open as Phil grabbed me, whispering,
there.
A scaly shape too long submerged. Phil pulled a pin and lobbed a bomb. It splashed and sank. It flashed. And whooped, a geyser plume rose up and fell. The ripples rocked us. I whispered, did you kill it? Phil released his safety, fumbling quick. I did the same. Beneath us, furious cataclysm raged and thrust and tumbled upwards, ledge and crag of hide and scale of horn. A mountain flung into the air and hung. Then downwards crash some limb or tail or tentacle into our puny vessel smash and crack the flames and fuck me from the shattered craft into the cold and churning river's frenzied froth. Beneath the surface, I panicked, flailed, but my flails found no ground to push against. Beneath the roiling waves, I desperate and reached in the mountains home. I found no peace. Some scaly thing then coiled around my legs. I pulled away, it tugged, and then it tugged again. A thousand knives clamped down around my legs and pulled them out, the water filled with blood. Then lights above us sudden shone with swirls of red and blue. A bullhorn's blast clubbed through the water. From the shore, a cannonade, hot shards of shrapnel through the monster hurled. The bullets thudded through the creature's hide, and some through mine. Its death row swung me, but its teeth dug deep into my flesh, and as it sank, it dragged me with it to its grave. The bottom's muck embraced me, limply hung my jaw, my burning lungs began to numb as hazy blankness settled, gently still in sweet and final calm, I welcomed death. The lights above me dimmed and slowed and drifted. Peaceful still, from some corner of my consciousness, a voice unquiet and insistent spoke. Not yet. Not yet! I screamed in bubbles as I tore its snout from my flesh. My burning lungs and legs in agony, I reached upwards, upwards towards the light.
So I don't get it. Did she die or did she not die?
It doesn't matter. That doesn't make any difference.
Typical American writing. You think that a metaphor is a good substitution for a resolution?
Fine. I had a resolution.
Oh, I get it. You watched Lost. It's like, let's end it with more questions than we started.
How did you watch? How do you watch Lost?
ABC has a contract with us.
I gotta talk to the president.
Hey.
Yeah?
Like water creatures?
Well, apparently.
Release the shark!
Oh, fuck.
This pleases me.
Madness. This is madness.
Hey, buddy.
I'm not your buddy, pal.
I'm not your pal, guy.
It's in South Park, did it, Kim Jong-un? What are you doing?
I'm gonna give you one last shot. As you can tell, there's only two people left alive here.
Yeah. So someone's dying after this next one.
I wonder who it will be.
I got a poem for you, Kim Jong-un.
Oh, about time.
There nothing's hung still like September, sweet and swelled with promise ripe and full.
Holly pertly bobs her head at me.
He hops the distant short as quack squawking the near gulls. Well, fine then, I mutter to myself, then sip my pinot, put it down, crack a lobster leg to suck it dry, and just for fun flash my eyes at Mark, who smiled, dowers to a frown.
In my suit, crumpled from my day, with my tie loose and my stubble slack, I stare somewhere not near Holly. My chin resting in my hand, I sigh, Holly replies.
Mark, dear, the seafood was delicious. And thank you so much for the sapphires. I sway to show them sparkle. Do you think I'll be beautiful tonight when... Well, dear, you know what's tonight. Mark coughs, clears his throat.
Sorry, it's just, Holly, tonight. Yes, I've been thinking. I know the world is always be amazing. You have a real talent there. But, this, it's the last time, dear.
Then I just laugh. You said that last weekend, Mark. You know it isn't over yet. You miss me too much. You miss the ways I love you that make you so happy. I know. Mark shifts his legs as waiters clear the plates and fidgets as they pour more wine.
As Holly sees the way that I twist my hips to hide like a teenage boy seen swelling in church, I try telling her, Holly, you know this isn't right, but Holly's leaning close enough that I feel her silk sheet breath.
He bites his lip and moans as he says,
God damn it. I tug my stare from our soft ripples, enticing my minds to her shallows and deeps. No, Holly, stop it. My wife, I can't do this to her. Damn it, honey, Janet cannot catch us. Do you know what she'll do to me? She loses sanity, she'll kill me.
Mark, stop it, I'm bored. Dinner's all finished, I think I'd like a shower. You want to come? Sometimes I'm lonely.
Say, I don't want you lonely. She takes my tie and tugs me towards her, so close that my whole world is her. I pant and stir and turn to face her, to kiss her, hold her, take her, be her, here, right here and now. I'll put her on this table, I reach out towards her, she dances away, not letting me.
I knew you wanted, I say, and then taking his leash, his mind all animal doggish, he follows. Then it's candles, slow rock, lingerie. He presses me and paws.
She takes my tie off and blindfolds me with it.
And bursts his buttons, ripping his shirt.
The tonguing and teasing and leading me downwards, she melts me.
I shove him hard on his back and cuff him. You're not allowed to move, I sigh. And he doesn't.
My belt slides, my pants, and I moan as she whispers so warmly, so wetly, so closely, but doesn't. Oh, please, Holly, I beg, please, just let me.
I do. And he's in me so deep.
But needs deeper. She breathes in my mouth, open-jawed, as she pushes and pushes.
He grips me and pulls me down on him, so perfect. He spreads me.
My fingers dug hard in her soft. She squeals and says,
harder, but leans upright, ripping off the blindfold.
Her hand on my chest, she pumps me and grinds me while sapphires glisten and flicker by candle. Her breasts firm, her skin tight, her eyes closed.
I shiver and clench and yank on his hair.
As she screams and she gasps, she flows down and around me and summons my passion. I'm done. The candles snuffed, our bodies cold and soft, long after, in that loving numb that comes to gauze the mind when loving's done, I coo and hold my lover close.
As I burrow sweetly in the sheets, I smile. So happy I hid that camera. Mark broke our next date, though. And then the next. So when we finally meet again on this occasion at a Radisson, and not our normal cozy seaside inn, I knew what to expect. I watched Mark's eyes, nervous and alert, scan the bar and door. He drinks whiskey, he drinks quickly, he says little, he stares nowhere. And he jumps when I ask, Mark, what's the big deal?
We're done. Finished. We're through, Holly. I can't keep on like this. This is the last time, and this time, yes, I do mean it. She's gone farther than I should have allowed, too far. So she ducks her head and cries, and then turns away to hide her tears while sneaking a glance back at me to check that they're effective. Don't cry. Please stop. Holly, I'm sorry. I don't mean to hurt you.
It seems as though you do. Was this your plan all along? You hurt me, Mark. You said you loved me. Are you a liar? Just say so now. Just say it. Say you don't love me and you never did. Right now. Just say it. Mark pays our tab and motions doorwards.
Let's go out for a walk outside where we can have privacy. Standing, she packs her purse, says,
fine.
And rising follows. We walk along the city's busy boulevard and turn into the city's park.
Hands in pockets, Mark frowns as we follow the paths deeper until underneath some fat oaks when I turn and say, "Did you have something to say? I'm sick of this way you treat me."
"I'm sorry, Holly, I fucked up bad. You are precious and kind and sweet, sexy, elegant, and unique. And I do love you, Holly, I do, but still there's Janet. You know, she's my wife. I swore I'd love her my whole life, and that's the way it is."
"If it's just Janet, there's no problem, big doof. I swear, sometimes you're like a child, Mark. Divorce your wife and marry me. You always talk about her like you're scared of her. Why don't you act a man, stand up, and leave her? Besides, she's old. She's a rag. She's stringy. And I bet she's all dried up inside. You know I'd make a better wife. I'll make you happy. You know I know how. Just do it. You're scared to say it, but I know you want to."
"No, no, 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 no. That will not happen. Never, never gonna happen. Janet is my wife, and I'm gonna love her till I die. This was just some silly fling I never should have gotten involved with."
"So just like that, you crawl back into Janet's bed, and Janet never knows that you left, and everything goes back to normal."
"Yeah, that's it. You got it."
"What if Janet knows, Mark?"
"Janet's not gonna know, though."
"What if I tell Janet?"
"Janet wouldn't listen to you. Don't be stupid. She'd never believe I'd do that."
"Oh, really? Would she believe it if she saw our video?"
"What? You fucking taped us? Don't you dare show that to Janet. You think you're gonna blackmail me? I never want to see your fucking face again. We're through, Holly.
Back home in my too small apartment, I paced and smoked and drank and paced for hours. I sit down in my laptop chair, open up my browser, log into my email, close it, and stand up and drink another cocktail until the room all aglow and warped by liquor. I sat down, typed in her email, uploaded the file, left the subject blank, and sent it. 2 weeks, without a word. I sat at home by night and worked my crummy job by day while Mark's last fury resounded in my mind. I drank alone and dreamed of his face, his touch, his hands, his embrace. Not as they were that day, that last and awful ugly day, but as they've been. Back when it was spring with promises yet unfulfilled and hopes of happiness as yet to be. Some Wednesday, I left work early, rode the bus home, climbed 4 flights of stairs despondently. My first and only thought, pour myself a drink. Janet sat smoking in my favorite chair, a cocktail on my table, staring cold and deadly like a viper coiled, hypnotizing me with the malice seeping potent from her off.
"Funny. Are you frightened? Come inside, sit down, we'll get to know each other. You already know me, but there's much you've yet to learn of me."
Smiling, she waited until I, entranced to softness, found a seat.
"You're pretty, child. So young. What are you, 28? You've learned some tricks, though, haven't you? I saw how proudly you put on your exhibition. Has it been so many men you've twisted? Maybe even some of them you thought you loved. Back when you were a younger girl, though. How come none of those before asked you to marry them? I guess they thought they could do better. Did they? Do you dream of them and their lovely wives while you sit here alone in this tenement? Or maybe you're more worried about rats and roaches. Oh, and of course, how you'll pay your rent. You wouldn't need worry if Mark were your husband, would you, dear? But he's not my fluffy bunny. Mark is mine, not yours. You didn't think you were the first to try and play this game with Mark, did you, dear? We've been married 27 years. I've had this talk before. And every time, it's the same. Some bubbly tramp sees Mercedes, Benz, and Mark and tries to sex him into marriage. Every time, I win. I let him have his fun, and then I take his toys away. I wiped your hard drive, you should know, so you haven't got that video. I found it on your email, too, and on the cloud. Don't bother looking for it. You can keep whatever little baubles he dressed you in. I wonder, were they sapphires again? He doesn't change. He's as he's always been, and as he'll always be. Remember him the next time you wear them. And remember me. You'll never see my man again. You're not the first. You're not the finest either. And he's forgotten all the rest. I'll give you some advice. Go dig your gold someplace else. Why don't you try Miami? There's plenty of sleazy money you could try seducing there, if competition doesn't scare you. What I'm saying is, go fuck somebody else's husband. Mine's off limits. Better do it quickly, though. 28's not all that young, you know. That's all. Take care now.
Janet ashes her cigarette out of my armrest, sips her drink, gathers her jacket and coat and purse, stands up, and dashes the dregs of her drink out in my face. She leaves me dripping as she crosses to the door and slams it hard enough to jilt a picture from the wall and shatter it against the floor. A stillness settles humid in the air as I breathe and breathe. And only breathe. Our nothings float like a seaweed carpet. Limp, entangled, turgidly propelled with no purpose or agency of their own.
See, I'm as cool, but it's never easy leaving your home, pero life is much better here in Miami. There's money to make. And Russian young ladies would love to get wild, aren't they? So tell me, te gusta mi jet ski?
Oh, not Sancho. If dinner's all finished, I think I'd like a shower. You want to come with me? Sometimes I'm lonely.
Oh, Holly, you know I don't want you all lonely.
As Sancho pays our bill and motions outwards towards southern Miami's southern sweltering heat.
A valet smooths the Maserati to a stop. We slide inside and glide away past brass bands on the street that blat their hot and rhythmic Latin beats while Sancho dreams of satin sheets.
And Holly wonders where it all went so wrong. As Sancho squeezes places, I'm not sure I like him squeezing. I stand and turn the key and open up the door to my suite where I see...
On my knees with a white rose in my hand. Holly, please, just listen to me here. There's something I need to tell you.
Who in the fuck is this fuck, huh?
Says Sancho. He's no one, Sancho. I used to be who he cheated on his wife with. Can you come back another night? I need to start screaming, and I don't want you to see that. I take a quick step backwards to lock the door and shut it. You fucking prick! You send your psycho bitch wife on me and throw me out like I'm garbage? Like I'm nothing? Like I'm just another slut? And then show up in Miami like a stalker? Jesus Christ! Christ, Mark, you're pathetic. A rose? Did you really think that was gonna work? Just fuck off!
I don't want that old bitch. I want you. That's why I'm here, for you. It's been awful. I'm so lonely. Janet's the worst. She's cold and she's cruel. She tortures me. Look, I've had it with Janet. Besides, I just can't forget about what we had. Look, I don't know what you did to me, but it's like, holy shit. I've never felt as alive as I do when I'm in you.
You love me when you're in me.
Well, other times too. I mean, all the time, all day long. Holly, please, all I'm asking is one more chance, okay? One night, then I'll leave. In the morning, if you still want me gone, then I'll leave. But I know you won't.
Oh, won't I? Is that your plan then? To fuck me and then leave me when you realize I'm not even worth your awful marriage? Sorry you came all this way for nothing.
I divorced Janet last week. Like I said, you're the one that I want. Come back north with me. Be my wife. Come home. I waited too long to do this as it is. I should have done it the first day I met you.
And I want to believe him so bad. I do.
As I inch on my knees towards her skirt,
and I giggle and push it all away and let him. Dawn impales my light as I wincing roll over to snuggle. But Mark isn't there. God damn it, how dare he! On the note on the table is a short handwritten note.
So last night, what I meant to say was...
And so on. I really thought he might have been different. I say as I stand alone. I don't think I'll ever believe it again. I sleep until the sun has higher risen, then peck a pomegranate breakfast, get dressed, and head to the beach. And now, it's sand, bikinis, hot wraps. As days in fluid break and recede, as after slow months pass, I finally realize I've got all I need, and I realize that where I'd retreated depleted had turned into home. Mark called me and called me and pleaded. I blocked his number and told him to eat it. One more time he showed up to try begging and whine about Janet and how.
She found out about last time, broke the glasses and the plates and the bowls, threw everything at me screaming, called her attorney and divorced me.
But for real this time, and oh, what a mistake he'd made. I said, drop dead, you sleaze. I'm with Sancho now, Mark. He treats me right. In Magusta, his jet ski.
What's it gonna be? Shit, it's gonna be amazing. Ready, man.
And Bill!
Ha 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 ha